My name is Koen Pijnenburg. I'm doing that in Dutch because I can pronounce it in English. I never tried it, so it's Koen Pijnenburg. I'm a co-founder and CTO of Concapps. It's a company based in Den Bosch. Maybe you know that place. Yeah, can you use that one? Oh, crap.
Oh, wait, sorry.
That's useless. Yep.
Oh. Yeah, close it.
The presentation is going to be in two parts. The first part is going to be a little bit of some story about myself. Also, I'm Dutch, so you can probably hear it from my English. And the next part, I'm going to tell you about Concapps, the company, about the apps in volume part. In early 2007, I imported an iPhone from the United States. And I thought by myself, this is a magnificent device. So maybe I'm going to write some software for it. But you probably already know, the App Store didn't exist in the first iPhone version, iPhone or iOS 1.0. The App Store wasn't announced yet. A lot of complaints. People want to write software for the iPhone. So in early 2008, the Steve Jobs announced the App Store in the presentation. He announced also that developers could subscribe to the beta developer program. I did that immediately. I entered the form and went to the site of Apple, and I got an email saying maybe you're going to be a part of the beta program, but I didn't care much about that at that time because the Apple didn't announce which developers were going to be in the beta program. So at one point I got an email from Apple saying this piece of text. Didn't really care about it, pressed it away, went on with my business at that time, building business applications. Then one time I was watching some news on a website, and I saw an article about the beta program that about 25,000 developers worldwide were subscribed to the beta program, but only about 3,000 were accepted. So I thought, I got this email, so I think I'm accepted to the program. So it says click here. So I bought the iPhone developer program, also the beta, the first beta. You need to buy it. It was not free. So I got accepted to the beta program. Had no idea what to do next. I had no idea for apps. I got everybody got the beta iPhone SDK, but nobody could release their app to the App Store, only the 3,000 people. And I was from the Netherlands, and maybe a handful of people from the Netherlands were accepted to the store. So at that time, I didn't have any ideas, and from an acquaintance of mine, I got in touch with some people, and that were the guys from probably the most people from the Netherlands know it, Bayerada. It's a site where you can a website where you can see actual rain in your neighborhood. So they said, can you write an iPhone app for us? I don't know. Nobody ever wrote an iPhone app, so I don't know anything about it. Very little documentation. You couldn't speak about it because it was all NDA. So I just went on with them, and basically I started working on the app. It was a very basic app in the beginning. This was the app. It eventually became the first Dutch iPhone app, of the Dutch language iPhone app in the store. At that time, maybe some of you had an iPhone when the App Store released. I think there were about 500 apps in the store, and two of that were mine. This was one, and the other was a card game. It was a really exciting time because maybe are there any iOS developers? Yeah. Do you like the part about the provisioning profiles? imagine that without documentation. And that was the first part of the App Store. It was hell. I think I've been working on the provisioning profiles half of the time of building the app. So you couldn't speak about it. There was a very little iTunes message board where you can ask some questions, but nobody really knew the answer. So it was really a crazy time. When I released the Bayrada app, I went on building a lot of other apps and got into some one app in the left top. This was a screenshot made at the same time. So at that time, Bayrada was the second best free app, and the WikiMe is a location-based app where you can get Wikipedia articles from your location. So if you walk around, you get a sort of a free tour guide. It was a big thing when it released in 2008. It's already 8 years ago. So nowadays, it's not a very special app, but at that time, there was really nothing. There was, when that app came in WikiMe in 2008, in August, there were about a few thousand apps in the store. So it was not very difficult to get in that list at that time. So it was, it was a very adventurous time in the beginning. So when I released WikiMe, I really like football. There are no Americans here, so I don't need to say soccer. But there wasn't really a good football app. So I basically started creating my own football app because I really wanted to use it myself. So I started out writing the app just for my personal use, but I put it in the App Store. I was already full-time writing apps. It was my main job at that time. I was working alone. I was a business owner with, how do you call it in the Netherlands, a ZZP. I went on writing My Football. It's the football app. In the first few months, it became a really a lot of downloads in the first. It was a paid app, but it was sold a lot. And when the App Store became one, I really noticed how much it was sold, because Apple used it in all their advertisements and went on. All kind of new graphics came out with Apple announcing the App Store, this was one, and I could spot the icon in every screenshot. So this was a very fun time. The app exists today still. It's called My Football Pro at this moment. My user base has been decreased over the years, and the first year there were almost everybody who liked football and had an iPhone downloaded this app. Nowadays there are a lot of competitors, so its mark has been the app is a little less popular than it was back then. Created a lot of other apps. I didn't really know at that time how to to get that same success I had with the football app. So I created other apps. I created one of the first My Steam apps. It's a Steam app that allows you to get you information about your friends on Steam. I got a cease and desist from Valve about this app. So I had to stop with that app. I created some other games and apps. I also went a bit to the dark side, creating that app. I really like games, so I created some games. The Coconut Riot is a sort of a Angry Birds-like app, and I released it in 2010. It was built with Unity 3D. Maybe you know it. It's a lot less popular than the Angry Birds was, but it was a nice game. And at that time I was a full-time app developer, earning my money all with app development. So I really tried to create games and apps that made some money. That didn't always work out like that one. So for me, one of the things that really helped me a lot was I was always a .NET developer. The first apps I created were all in Objective-C. I was very glad Xamarin came at that time with MonoTouch, because I could skip the Objective-C and start with .NET. I really immediately started building my apps with MonoTouch, because I had a lot of customers at that time. Hey, can you build my app? But I want an iOS app and an Android app. Yeah, and if you need to maintain an Objective-C code base and a Java code base, it's really hard to make some money about building that app. So when Mono for Android and MonoTouch came, it was a clear choice to build all my apps in Xamarin. My Football Pro was one of the first. The first app I built was in Objective-C. Then I threw that away and started building the app in Xamarin. I even got some bug solving from the man there. Mike knows him well, Miguel. It was something clear that Xamarin and the way I was building apps was really the future for me. In 2012, I met with Hans, that guy, that's Hans Donkers. At that time, I was building a lot of custom apps, and I really got tired of doing all the things over and over. So, all the same things, so building news lists, and I really didn't want to do that anymore. So I started to create a sort of a CMS, and a content management system to sustain and maintain apps. At first, it wasn't really a pet project of mine. It was an experiment. But when I met with Hans, I showed him what I had at that time, and he was pretty amazed about that product at that stage. So we started the company in 2012, and the philosophy of the company is really to build apps for small businesses. So we don't do any custom app design. We only do we sell subscriptions. So a small business like a fitness club, elementary school, they want an app. They go to Hans or his sales team. They get a presentation, and it's very basic. They sign on the spot usually, and usually 2 months later their app is live. So the basic idea about what we do is we try to get as much apps in the store because our subscription is very, very low. So the idea is to get a lot of apps in the store, so we need to make a lot of sales. So when you try to manage something like that, you need to go ahead and do some things that you normally do as a developer, so like doing builds or testing or that kind of stuff. So we have our own platform. We have our own CMS. We have our own iOS and Android base app. And for 2 years now, we also offer WordPress websites from the same CMS. The idea is very simple. A small business user don't want to get want to design their own app. Is our ideas the small business user don't want to design their own app. They like to enter a news item in the CMS and get it out in as much places as he can, like Facebook and the app at the website. So we the product we offer is a communication cockpit, we call it. So the idea is that the user enters some news item, and the news item is published to iOS, Android, website, Facebook, and Twitter. So they can choose that themselves, but that's the idea about the product. This is the communication cockpit. So this is more sales screenshot thing. So the idea is the user, the customer, he wants an app or a website, and he don't want to create their own design, and they don't want to get the hassle of doing custom design and custom things. So we take care of all that things for the customer. So we basically say to the customer, get us your logo, and we do the rest. So that's basically the best way to get the small businesses in the Netherlands to get something useful out of the App Store. So our primary focus is on specific verticals. So we only do business in these markets. These are a few of our labels. So I was looking at a fitness club in Veenendaal. It's called La Vita. Maybe somebody knows it. It used to be a customer of ours, so they quit the app. Otherwise, it was a nice thing to see. But we basically focus on gym apps, basisschool apps. It's like elementary school. So it's an app for the parents. They download the app, do make appointments on school. In the future, we are going to add small payment transactions. For swimming, we do child progress connections with third parties. For fitness, we do a lot of third-party connections with big machine builders like Techno Gym and Life Fitness. Maybe you know that brands. We really try to focus on specific verticals. We don't do any business besides these verticals at the moment. Purely to get a lock-in in the market, like the gym apps label. Right now there are about 300 fitness clubs in the Netherlands who have an app to the gym apps label. So it's very hard for a competitor to get in the same market and deliver the same product as we have at in that market. So we go really deep in the market. Maybe you know a product called App Machine. Maybe somebody knows it. Yeah. The product we have is basically the same, but our approach was slightly different than their approach. Their approach was to give the customer all the control of the app, what's in the app, how the app looks, also basically how it got in the store. At the beginning, we basically saw that the small business in the Netherlands are very lazy. They want to do basically nothing. So we said, why don't we do it all for them? So we started taking care of all the things for them. The only thing they do themselves, because we don't want to get involved with content, they do their own content in the app. So these are some building blocks. It's in Dutch. Sorry about that. But basically, the app we deliver is an empty shell. So when a customer comes to us, and it's a gym apps customer, we say, okay, you probably want the less rooster for Mike. It's the roster. You get the contact block, you get a form, you get polls, social media. So we put all the building blocks in the configuration for that specific customer, and we tell the customer basically always three choices, because we think if we let the customer choose from 10 things, he's probably going to go to some colleagues and have some meetings about it. We give them always three choices. The choices about design will be chosen on the spot. So it's all about, it's really basically a small factory we run. So it must always be quick, and the choices of the customers have to be really fast. So the building blocks, we basically work with templates. So we say, oh, you are a swimming school, you probably want this. If you don't like it, tell us. So we just start with creating an app for the customer. We have special delivery guys at the Concapps. Those are full-time non-developers, but pretty technical guys who start from scratch, build an app, put building blocks in the app, make third-party connections. We have all kinds of third-party connections who are standardized, so we don't do any customization for the customer for that. It's like that. Do you want a roster? Do you want to make class bookings with your third-party software you use on the club? We make the connection, and people can do reservations from within the app. So this is, I'm going to switch to this one. I told a bit earlier, it's like we do a lot of interfaces. It's not a nice thing to maintain, because you all have worked with third-party APIs. The really cool APIs, the REST APIs, who work perfect, they are the nicest, but we have to work with almost bankrupt fitness member software. They have crappy connections. They have usually their documentation comes in the email. It's really hard to. Almost all work still with a client server model, where the server exists on the club itself. So when the system administrator resets the router, usually the connection is down. It's really hard to maintain those connections. But it's commercially it's really a lock-in. So if users can book classes from within the app, it's something the lock-in causes the customer to probably never leave us, because they won't get the same connection and the same app with another competitor. So that's why we do a lot of interfaces. Our apps are Sometimes it's pretty hard to, when you have, at the moment we have 700 apps in the store for iOS, 700 for Android. It's really hard to get some different looking apps. So what we do is we go to the customer, we usually go to the website. Hey, they have a lot of yellow. Fit for Free is a big fitness company. This is a little bit of different. This is a small other branch of ours. We do also build apps for funeral homes. It's a different branch. So we go to the customer, we go to the website, we ask for the logo. The delivery guys from us starts building the app. They put the building blocks in the app, create a color screen, and choose some icons for from our library. And then the app gets out to the customer. And one of the things we do is maybe someone who worked with Test Flight for iOS tried to do that with a few hundred customers, and that of on a monthly basis, it's not fun. So one of the first things we did was create an app where we can do the testing from within our own app. So we have an app called App Viewer, Concapps App Viewer, who basically is the same app as that, but can read every configuration that we have in our CMS. So we tell the customer, download the App Viewer, go to the enter this login, and they get their own app, can fill their content, and they send us an email. Hey, I've already gotten all my content in the app. Please get my app live. Then some process that us starts, and the guys get the app to the store. So it's really probably a different way of working with apps than some of you do. So at one point we thought, well, nice, we have apps, but why don't we do websites? So we chose WordPress. It's also a commercial choice. We could have used, we could have built it on ourselves, or we could use Umbreco or something like that. But in small businesses in the Netherlands, everybody has a kind of a WordPress website. So they get somebody's nephew writes a simple WordPress website, and for a few hundred euro, they get their own website. So we thought, why don't we also use WordPress? They are already familiar with that. So we started to create our own WordPress themes. Maybe you know WordPress and the theming abilities of WordPress a bit. So we only use the styling part of WordPress themes. The rest is all connected to our own CMS and our own data. So so right now the customer can say, okay, I want an app and a website, and I can maintain it from the same CMS. This is the CMS. It doesn't look very special. It's always a specific choice. As I said earlier, we have a lot of small business customers. They don't really understand computers. So what we do is a very basic, simple system. You log in, you say, I want to change my content. You press on a button, and then you get your building blocks on the left. You say, I want to add a news item. You press news, you say, add item. It's like so simple as that. So otherwise, we would have gotten a lot of emails about for our support guys to help users with simple things. So we don't want to do that. We want to keep it as simple as possible. Right now, we only sell apps in the Netherlands and Belgium. We have about 700 apps live at the moment. If you have an iPhone and you search Concapps in the App Store, It's like unlimited scrolling. We have about, for all apps combined, we have 1 million app downloads. It's all only in the Netherlands, about 200 websites live at the moment. And we have pretty much 730,000 registered users for push, so that are all different apps, so we can send a push message to that amount of people, but the users cannot do that themselves. Press the right button. For a development note, I think most of you work on, always work on different projects. It's pretty hard to keep working on something you created in 2012 and keep on working on that. One of the things that are really something when you have a product with unlimited features, almost you can have a problem to get to, easy to get lost. Some sales guy comes to you say, I want that feature. Some support guy say, we need to have this because I can't do my job. So it's really hard to really prioritize the things you want to do in the project. Also, keep it simple. We have a lot of junior developers. If you create really difficult things, they don't understand what you try to do. And maintaining it and adding new features will be very hard. And also, maybe you all work with Scrum. It's a product that always runs, so you need to always do releases. So we always do continuous releasing with Scrum. So that's the most easy way to keep the product up to date. A small part about volume. The things we did was we got non-developers to do releases and builds. Maybe you think with 700 apps we do all the updating to the stores automatically, but we don't do anything automatically. We do everything manually. So it's a lot of work. The basic reason for that is that when you, maybe someone tried to do automatic updates on the Google Play Store, you pretty much get banned really quickly. Google will suspend your account because you are doing it all from an automatic platform. They don't like that. So what we basically do, we do everything automatically until the process of getting it in the store itself. We do that by hand. So Google and Apple can never say, hey, you did it with an automatic tool. It's something to, anybody got an account suspended from, or an app suspended from Google at some point? No, it's not easy to get that back. And Google is even worse than Apple with reviewing. They always do everything afterwards. So when you update an app to Apple and they go to the review process, and when it's okay, they release it. Google just accepts it, runs some scanning tools on the app, and if they see a logo, we had it the other day. They see a logo in the app. It looks like a logo they know, suspend the app. And you don't even get a reason why they did it. You have to contact Google and try really hard. And sometimes they say, we don't going to release the app again. You need to create another build. You have to create another name for the app. Try to tell that to the elementary school you just released the app for. So we try to do as much manually. We always try to simplify configuration for the customer. So We don't want to get in several meetings with the customer about how the app will look. It's not the product for that. It's basically a cheap product. So all the customers pay a monthly subscription for the app, but we try to keep it as simple as possible. We don't do any, I won't say any, but almost none customization. Basically because when you start building customizations for customers, it you can't maintain the apps anymore. And the guys make a lot of sales, so it's really something you need to do. You need to do a lot of sales because if you don't do a lot of sales for this kind of product, it won't work. Something I was told about earlier. Delivery is a call it delivery engineer at Concapps. It's a job that didn't exist before. They do full-time delivery. They do they create builds. They test. They make sure the customer gets what he wants. They get it in the store. They even support. They do pretty much everything I don't really want to do. So. Also, one thing that the last line when I told you we have 700 apps and we do it all manually, every app is also updated at least 2 times a year. It's in their subscription, so we have a lot of updates as well. We do that for 700 apps with 2 guys at the moment. So. It's a lot of work, but it's manageable. So we really like doing it manually because the quality of the product who gets to the customer is something with automated tools sometimes are a bit less. We have some internal tools specifically built for creating our own apps. What we do are we have a template project file. So when you go into Xamarin Studio or Visual Studio, you say new project. We have that all templated. So the guys who make the builds only basically know the build menu in Xamarin Studio or Visual Studio. They don't even know how to write one line of code. So everything is simplified for the guys. We create a project. We even say what kind of banner. Every app that starts has a logo or a vertical banner in the bottom. They create the project. They create the icon for the app, but they don't create all the icons, and they don't create the defaults or the startup screens. They create one logo and one sometimes one background file, and all the graphics are automatically created by the tool. And they basically wind up with the project they can run, and they only have to connect the app configuration from the CMS, and then the app runs. So it's really easy. We can configure apps for customers in the CMS, but at one point I thought it was a bit of a lot of work to create the apps in the CMS. There were a lot of simple things I couldn't do. We have the backend is in ASP.NET MVC. I'm really more an app developer than a backend developer, so I created this iPad app for our internal delivery users. It's basically an app that creates apps. So maybe I can show it in a minute, then I can walk through the Dutch Meetup app. I created the Dutch Meetup app for this occasion. This app can basically do everything. They can set interfaces with other third-party software, they can add new building blocks. The Bouwsteen is building blocks. You can add new building blocks. You can say, I want it on the website as well. You can create submenus, submenus. You can change the icon. You can say, you can change the title. We have all kind of content types, like you see in the behind the news. You have news. That's the content type. So you can have multiple types of news in your app. You can create basically what you want. They run this tool, and at the end they say upload, and the configuration gets uploaded to the CMS. And at that time, it's not something the tool is used by also some people who really don't really know a lot. So when you upload the app, the delivery guy needs to say, okay, I accept this. So it's a sort of a workflow thing. This is what I earlier said, it's for Android and iOS. It's an app viewer. It's a very simple app. It only has a login screen. And after you log in, you get your own app you bought, and you can see it. When you don't like the color scheme, you say to the delivery guys, hey, I want another color scheme. We don't have to do the manual builds. We don't have to ask for people's... when we used test flight, we had to ask about a unique identifier from the device. It speeds the testing a lot. This is a very important tool. It pretty much, when you're building such kind of this kind of platform, these kind of apps were created by accident. This app wasn't planned. I just was one night as I was sitting watching television or something. At one point I thought the testing we do is really cumbersome. It's slow. It's really not really getting apps really fast to the store. So this app is created in a couple of days because we already all had all the code for presenting the apps. We only needed to create this first login screen. When we try to make a lot of more features, we always look at what kind of things we can develop next. One thing our customers really wanted to have was an app for managing their app. So we created an app. It's built in Xamarin Forms by that guy. It's Getjan. It was his first Xamarin Forms app. He only worked 1 month at Concapps. And we already built this app. So customers can use this simple app to add a new news item, add an image that was taken on the phone. It's really easy for getting some content in the app. This is the meetup app I created. I must say it, you created. You can download the app viewer from the store and use that login, and you can see the app we created to demonstrate the product what the customers get. So usually the customers go and see in the app, and we added some news, events. It's in Dutch, but sponsors, photos. We took some content from the meetup website. We created the logo. So it's basically pretty much how we get to work and get some apps in the store. I can show you the tool. This is an internal tool, so this isn't in the App Store. Luckily, you can basically do three things here: as create a new app, create a new app copied from another app, sometimes they do that, update an existing app. So when the guys go in this tool, they go to configure app. They can add basic data like telephone number, email, website. We don't want a lot of data. We have a lot of different types of apps. So we have the uitvaart apps, it's the funeral apps. We have the gym apps. So this app is a business app. It's more like an umbrella label. So if it isn't a gym app or a swimming app or an elementary app, it's a business app. So what kind of subscription do you have? So here's it's something that's really basic, but for an internal tool, they just have to select like a big member software in the Netherlands is for gym app, for fitness clubs is BOS. We only say BOS, send us an API username and password or an API key for this customer. We get the API key. The delivery guy goes to the CMS. They don't understand anything about APIs. Enter the API key, and the connection is made. We can do bookings from within the app. And we have a sort of a standardized solution for booking classes for the same interface is built for BOS and for Control Plus, LogiFit. It's all based on the same set of features, booking classes and the integration in the app is for all the third-party software is all the same. Here is a small list of the. You can they can arrange the sections. They can change the name like. They can change the icon. We have quite a set of icons. So they can set another icon. They can even change the name. So now I have changed the configuration of the app a bit. They can also add new building blocks. Can add a new list. It's just a basic list, and we can call it blog. And then when we create this, we upload it to the CMS, and the customer can log in the CMS, can immediately edit their blog that we created. So going to switch a few screens. This is we call it a ninja tool internally. It's for the delivery guys itself. It's for configuring the apps a little more advanced. Some people see this screen, most people don't. And when I'm here, I can say upload this app to the CMS, and then it will say that's. It worked. If I got some internet. No. Not the best demo. No. Don't get through the internet. Okay.
Are you using a specific port?
It didn't work.
Are you using a specific port to upload? Not the default 80 or
that could be for our web service, yeah.
Yeah, probably because I know a lot of ports are blocked here.
I'm going to switch to the alternative. It's the CMS itself. It's no internet. No internet.
Try reconnecting, I don't know.
try turning it off and on again. That won't work. But basically, you can change the building block, the title, and when we change it, the maybe some guys already have the app viewer on their app, on their phone installed. We can immediately see the change we made in the app, so the customer can start creating their content and add some more. So maybe you want to download it, want to see it. I can't show it in the simulator because I don't have the internet at the moment. But you can try it, and you can see how our system works. And if Marco or Roy say, hey, we want to have that app in the store, we can upload it to the store. That's basically how our product works. So it worked? Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Great. That was my story. So anybody got any questions?
Yeah, I got a question.
Yeah.
So you kind of told that the basic project is sort of a template project.
Mm-hmm.
You have for Xamarin Studio or Visual Studio. How do you go about in terms of bug fixes and platform updates from the Xamarin platform? Is that the one project that you then update, and then it's how does that work across all these apps?
We work a bit in two different ways. At one point, we contacted Xamarin about using resources in assemblies for Android. I don't know if anybody tried that, but it's not quite stable. So we use all our resources in our template project. So the basic problem for Android for us is that we have to maintain some different template files for the project. For iOS, we can do all the resources in assemblies. So we have different sets of assemblies for resources. So we can maintain that a little bit easier. So it's something like with bug fixes. We have the main problem we have is when we create something for the CMS, like a new feature. Like the other day, we created a feature where you can add a notification, and it's not a push notification. We already had it, but an in-app notification. So if there's one guy working on the app and the other guy working on the CMS, if he is really fast and he creates the notification feature for the CMS and he uploads the CMS to the Azure, I always say Azure. I heard tonight it was Azure. Or is it American to say Azure? Okay. Okay. Perfect. Then the feature is already online, but no user of apps has that feature. So we created an extra layer to say, okay, this app is on this functional level. And we also use that in the CMS. So when an app is on a particular level, then only that feature will be enabled in the CMS. So we try to separate that kind of features. Okay. Anybody? Another question?
No.
Yeah, a different fee. The problem is with fitness clubs in the Netherlands and maybe also in other countries, they get or bankrupt or get acquired by a big chain like Basic Fit, is a known chain in Netherlands. So the gym apps label was the first label we started. We started with a certain price. We stick to that price. But then we started to sell apps to schools, and they say they don't have any money, but they do have a lot of money. So we charge a bit higher of a subscription for the elementary schools. We also sell for big cities like the city of Almere. We have an app called Sportief Almere. It's an app for a user to find different verenigingen. It's like finding the badminton club or the tennis club or the in the and we have a search template for that, and we can sell for the same price to the fitness club as for the big city, but they have a lot of more to spend, so the app gets a little bit bigger. We put more building blocks in it, and we sell it for a bit higher price. So it's hard to get everything on the same price. So that's why we do the specific verticals. We can set our own price in the vertical. So that's the way we do it. So, yep.
How do you monitor the app crashes?
Sorry, the app crashes.
Yeah.
We do that in our own system. So we don't use Xamarin Insights for that. We have our own logging mechanism for logging the exceptions for the app and the CMS in the same system. We don't bother users with strange cryptic error messages. It just works or don't work. So we don't do any very complicated exception handling on the app itself. It's basically we monitor it ourselves, and we pretty much when the logging and when we get the same exception messages from different apps, and the exception message is the same, it's something we clearly need to do about it. So we need to fix a bug or something like that. So we get a lot of exceptions. So also from the third parties, like the interfaces, it's hard to maintain. We can have a connection with a third party, like 50, and 49 can work, and one cannot work. So, So we do it all in our own CMS, maintain it ourselves. Yeah.
Okay. Due to the time constraint, I think this is it. I want to thank you.
Well, okay.